Hello and welcome. In this video, we are going to take a look at our current P5. This video is going to be part of a series of videos that sort of gives you some hints about how to get started with the current P5. The current P5 focuses on the calculations associated with various geometric properties of cross sections. This video assumes a number of things. Number one is that you've been following along with this series of videos and particularly have either started or completed your P3 modified. We're going to be borrowing a lot of the logic and some of the techniques that we saw in that project for use in this one, with the big difference being is we are going to be passing parallel vectors or parallel arrays to our function so that the function can focus solely then on the calculations and nothing having to do with presenting the resulting values. This video also assumes that you have obtained a copy of the P5 instructions for this project, have a copy of the P5 sample.txt, and optionally then the P5 setup.c, which really is just there to help us get started. And if anything, I encourage you to go back to the instructions and actually start your P5 without using the P5 setup. So let's go ahead and get started here. In this video, what I'm going to do is I'm going to focus on setting up the structure of our program, the command line arguments that will allow for us to call our functions, and how we will ultimately pass our arrays. Now, I'm not going to do any of the testing or anything like that in this particular example. We're going to focus on that in other videos. So let's go ahead and get started. If you'll read through the instructions, you'll notice that they are very similar to the earlier projects, particularly the P3 modified, in that we have to choose one of the cross sections, and then ultimately we will be prompted then for the input associated with those cross sections. So for instance, if it was the circular cross section, we want to look at a maximum radius for that circular cross section, a minimum radius for that circular cross section, and then ultimately how many values in between do we wish to calculate. And so I've given you an example here, basically starting with 1 going down to 0.75, and I want 3 values. So the resulting values will be then 1.875 and then 0.75, basically equally distributed. Now, I have not populated these values here because I intend for you to go through and figure out those calculations. But ultimately, what we want to do is we want to calculate then the edge, the area, the IX, IY, and IZ. And for this particular project, we're going to do two things. We are going to give a nice output to the user on the console. But then if you go back to the instructions, you'll notice that you also have the additional requirement of outputting to a CSV file. And if you'll notice here, the format is a little bit different. In the CSV file, we want to provide the radius, the edge, the area, IX, IY, and IZ, all on one row, as opposed to in the table where we have all of the values associated with the edge on one row, all of the values associated with the area on one row, et cetera. So basically, we're going to be presenting this information two different ways to the user. So we'll show how that works in a later video. I wanted to just get started in this one. You'll notice that what I've done is I've simply used my P5 setup to bring over all of the function prototypes, the constants, and so on. And you'll see here now I have my main setup. Obviously, I will need to go through and update these comment blocks as appropriate. But the idea is in this video, I'm going to focus just on how to call our circle 2DV4. In other words, I want to set up all of the moving pieces here for one of the functions so that you can see then how you would do it for the other functions. Now, optionally here, we can leverage our P3 modified, and particularly what I'm interested in looking at is the triaging of the command line arguments, because effectively it's going to be the same. You'll notice here that I have two possibilities. One is that I have an interactive mode, which calls our circle property, or rather looks for the properties associated with the circle. And I also have my parametric mode, And you'll notice that basically what I'm looking at is then the number of arguments, and that's what fundamentally differentiates between these two. The interactive one allows for you to ask the user questions using a combination of printfs and scanfs, whereas the parametric mode requires that the values are passed as additional arguments, and you are then simply responsible for converting them over to the appropriate data types and then passing them to the function. Again, this is for our P3 modified, but the process is going to be very similar. You'll notice particularly when you take a look at the function signature associated with the Circle 2DV2 modified, and you come up here and you take a look at the function signature associated with the Circle 2DV4, that the first part of the function signature, as well as the last part of the function signature, are in fact the same. What has changed is that we are passing these additional variables here that correspond to the parallel arrays that we will update inside the function. Now, what does this allow for us to do? Well, it means that in this example right here, if you were to actually look at the function, you then had the obligation to print inside the function the table. In other words, the table output was very similar for your P3 modified, but you had to print this inside the function. Now, by using these parallel arrays that we can update inside the function, we no longer have to do that. And instead, what we can do is we can actually then print the table in our main, leaving the sole responsibility for calculating the values and, of course, validating the input arguments to the function. In other words, the function is now solely responsible for the calculations, nothing else, not collecting the data nor displaying the data. So what we can do is we can actually go ahead and borrow our logic here from our main, from our P3 modified. What I'm going to do is I'm going to redo it, even though it takes us a little bit longer here. I'm going to do it piece by piece and explain it to you just to make sure that you understand what we're trying to do here. And I'm also going to wire up this Circle 2DV4 so we can call it, just to make sure that we, in fact, have our main and our function wired correctly, meaning that we can now call it. So to begin with, the first check that I want to do is just simply that I actually have some reasonable number of arguments. In other words, I want to check that my argument count is in fact not less than one. And the easiest way to do that is to check to see if it is less than or equal to one. And if it is, then I simply want to call our help. And again, this is an implicit call for help, meaning that the user basically just didn't know how to use our application and just typed the name of the executable. Now, I'm going to go ahead and jump to the else just because we also want to catch the scenario where maybe we haven't thought through our logic appropriately, or if there was a scenario that we didn't get. And again, this is an implicit call for help. They didn't explicitly ask for help. Now, what we can do is inside of here, we will focus on some of the scenarios that we've seen, again, in multiple projects. And that is going to be the scenario in which the user actually explicitly wants our help. And what we do is we simply look using our string compare I function at our argument square brackets one. Remember that square brackets one represents the first switch that comes after the name of the executable. Remember that the executable itself is our argv square bracket zero. And in this case, we can check for a variety of options. We can check to see if it is equal to slash h. And what we can do here is we can actually leverage a little bit of copy and pasting. We can also look to see if it matches the slash question mark. And if either of those are in fact true, then we will simply now make an explicit call for help. Now, let's make sure real quick that we actually have our parentheses matched correctly. So those appear to me match correctly. And then here, let's make sure that these outer ones are matched correctly. And so far it looks good here. Let's make sure that we've got an extra set around this one. And there we go. So at least we can now handle our help. Now, let's look at the next option. In other words, the one that is actually relevant to calling our function. And if you recall, again, from your P3 modified, or if you look at our P5 sample, you'll know then that if we have a total of three arguments, and particularly that the second and third argument were /circle/i, we knew that we wanted to call our interactive mode. And so effectively what we want to do is we want to check now three conditions. The first one simply being that our arg c is equal to 3. The second condition is that our arg v square brackets 1 is equal, or rather using our string compare I, is going to be a match to our argv square brackets 1 and /circle. And if that is true, as well as the third condition, string compare I matches our argv square brackets 2, and if that matches then our /i, well, that simply means that we want to call our interactive mode for our circle calculations. And again, what we want to do is make sure that we have our parentheses matched correctly. And in this case, then what we want to do is go ahead and set this up by providing a print statement. You can say something like note calling our /circle/i. Now, again, we're going to come back to this in just a second. We'll improve some of this. You'll actually see how we're going to have to do this differently in this particular example. But you can again go back to our P3 modified for a little bit of guidance here. And you'll see that at this point, then we simply prompt the user for the individual pieces of information, the radius max, the radius min, and the n. Now, we've got a couple of options here. We can either go ahead and blindly copy and paste, or we can talk through these here. What we want to do here is we actually want to go ahead and declare these values. So we'll start off with our int n. Our double for our radius has to be, our radius max rather has to be a double, and then our radius min also needs to be a double. Now, as a good standard procedure here, I highly encourage you to go ahead and initialize these values as soon as you declare them. This just prevents you from accidentally forgetting to do that and potentially some unwanted results. So it's always a good habit to get into to initialize our values. And in this case, we have initialized our three values. Now, while we're up here, why don't we go ahead and take a second to create one more value here, one more variable. We're just simply going to call this results. We're actually going to use it when we are calling our functions. And the idea here is that the results will tell us whether the functions were successful or if they failed. And again, we might as well go ahead and take a second to initialize this value, although ideally, we will never run into a situation where we do not have a results from one of our functions. Now, once we've accomplished this, then what we can do is we can go about setting up these prompts. I'm going to cheat just a little bit here in that I'm going to do a little bit of copying and pasting here with the common code just to speed this up. So I know that I'm going to have three prompts. The first one is going to ask the user to please enter a radius max. And it would be very useful for the user if you told them the units that you would like. We can again do this for our radius min. And then we also want to have a prompt for the number of values that we wish to calculate. So please enter an n. Now, optionally, what you can do here is you can actually tell the user that it needs to be greater than or equal to 2. We did not do that in the earlier demonstration, and that's okay too. Again, as much information as you can provide to the user without confusing them, the better your application will feel to the user. And then at this point, then we can have our scanf capturing our percent LF. And we want to store this then at the address of our radius max. And I think you can quickly see where we're going with this. We're going to do the same thing now for our radius min. And then, of course, the difference being with our n, then we have a different format spec. That is going to be our percent d. But again, we are going to store it at the address of n. Now, at this point, we would simply go through and we would say results are going to be equal to, and then we would call our function. Well, the problem is in this particular scenario, we don't have all of our variables correctly identified yet. And specifically, we've done nothing yet to handle these vectors or arrays of the radii, the edge, the area, Ix, Iy, and Iz. So in order for us to even be able to do this, we have to go ahead and declare these variables. Now, we are not going to go through and initialize these in this particular case, because we're going to assume that the function will initialize them and will handle them as well as the return value. Although you could simply go ahead and initialize all these values, we're going to rely a little bit on the logic that we will ultimately use in our helper functions or in our functions that do the calculation. But what we want to do now is we want to come up here and we want to go ahead and declare our additional variables here. So we're going to have a double radii. And what we're going to do is waste space. We will come back to how we can dynamically allocate these arrays. But to begin with, what we're going to do is we're going to statically declare them. And to specify the size, we could either hard code a value in here, or we can use our constant n max. Now, the advantage with using a constant is then you can leverage it in the logic, in the functions that we call, and you'll see how we do that in our next video. We'll do the exact same thing now with each of the other arrays or vectors that we wish to pass. And basically what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go through the function signature here. You can either use the prototype up here or look down here to see which variables need to be passed. Again, these variable names do not have to be the same. I'm just doing this for convenience sake, but basically we want to have an edge. We want to also have an area. We will have then our Ix. And notice how all of these are being declared as doubles, and also all of them will have the same number of elements. And that is, again, trying to reinforce this idea of these parallel arrays. Now, fortunately, some of these arrays we will actually use in multiple functions, but you will be adding some additional variables as you add the other functions. And so you'll end up with quite a few variables declared. And then again, arguably not an efficient use of memory. And we'll come back to this and we'll tweak this then later on. And what do I mean by that? Well, you've got four functions in your executable. You're only going to be calling one of them at a time. So why would you go through the trouble of allocating memory for functions that you never intend to call? I think you can quickly see why this would be a waste of memory. Again, we'll come back to that in a later video, but by simply declaring these variables now, that means that we can make a call to our circle 2DV4, passing to it not only the values that we already have captured from the user, and I'm trying to get our autocomplete here to pop up for us, give a little bit of a hint, and you'll see there, then we can pass to it the radius max, the radius min, the radii, this is now the vector or the array, we want to pass the edge, we want to pass the area, we'll pass the Ix and the Iy, as well as the IZ. And then the last variable that we cannot forget to pass is our N. And remember now, the N is what says how many values do we actually want to calculate. We may allocate 20 spaces in memory for each one of these arrays, but we may actually only use 5 or 6 of them. Or if you follow the example for P3 sample, for the first one, we only use 3. All right, so let's go back now. And once we've captured the results here, we will actually want to leverage an if statement here. So we might as well go ahead and throw this in here. And what we're going to do is we're going to compare those results to our exit success. And if we do have exit success, then here is where we want to start printing and F printing for files the values from those arrays. And so the idea here is that we've been successful at calculating them. Now we can move on to actually printing them. And so I'm going to follow this up with a quick, a comment to the user here, maybe a note, progress statement, however you want to think of it. And I'm just going to say attempting to print and fprint output. And again, probably something you may want to consider removing when you get done with your application. But under the else branch, we'll simply put error, failed to calculate values. And again, make this message as dire as you feel appropriate. But this will also help us with a little bit of our logic in our later videos to figure out where we want to put the remainder of the code. For now, what I want to do is I actually want to focus in on our circle 2D. And I'm going to go here to the function itself. And again, we're not going to do any calculations in this video. What I would like to do, though, is I would like to let the user know that we are calling it. And so I'm just going to put another print statement in here. So printf calling. And again, I'm going to perhaps cheat a little bit or maybe be a little lazy, depending on which way you want to look at it. But basically, I'm just going to put a message in here that says that I am calling this particular function. Now, we're not changing anything about the results. So in this case, this will always return exit success for now until we do some checking on our input arguments, which we are, again, not going to do. You could also consider printing the input arguments here. So you could print your radius max, your radius min, and your n. Again, it would be probably a good idea. It would help you get started with building then the functions and making sure that they're working. For now, we're just going to go ahead and build this one. We're going to make sure that we don't have any errors. That looks very promising. I'm going to go ahead and cd here. I tell you what, why don't we just exit this command window and start over. And so I'm going to change to my documents, courses, EE233, projects, and then now this is going to be for our P5. I'm going to go down my dist folder, debug, and then mingw. And you'll see there is my p5.exe. And if I just type in p5, I should get the help, as meager as it is right now. And what I'll do now is I'll start passing some switches just to check to see if our logic is solid so far. Again, yes, I have my /h. It appears to be working. My /?? Appears to be working. And so what we'll do is we'll now move on to the /circle/i. And we are being asked now to put in values for the radius max, the radius min, and the number for n. And you'll see here that it's telling me that I'm calling it. And now I've got another note that says attempting to print and fprint the output. Again, that means that my results were successful. Tweak these how you feel appropriate, how you feel it's necessary. But the idea is you can tell now that we've got this one wired up correctly. Now, what we'd like to do is we'd like to go back to main one more time. And again, we are going to use as a guide our P3 modified as well as our P5 sample and be reminded of the fact that if I pass these values parametrically, then my total argument count actually goes up. So in other words, I'm going to have 1, 2, three, four, five, six arguments. And I'm going to be specifically looking at the second and third argument for the switches. And then I'm going to assume that the appropriate numeric values were passed to our executable. Again, we're going to triage those inside of our function. And so at this point, then what we'll do is we will have another else if branch. And again, what we're going to do is we're going to start off looking at the argument count. So my RC is going to be equal to 6. And then what we do is we look at the following switches using string compare I. Particularly, we're going to be looking at argv square brackets 1. And we want to see whether it looks like circle. And if that matches as well as the third thing that we want to check, then is going to be that third argument using string compare I. So, whoops, sorry, got ahead of myself there. String compare I of argv square brackets 2. And we simply want to check to see if it matches this slash p. And if those match, in other words, if all three of those conditions are true, then what we need to do is we need to blindly proceed toward capturing or converting the fourth, fifth, and sixth arguments to their appropriate data types. And so remember that when you pass arguments on the command line, that they're going to come in as strings, and we need them to be numeric values. And so we'll start off now with our radius max, and we're going to use a function called a2f that will allow for us to convert then our argv square brackets 3 to the radius max. The a2f simply takes a string and converts it then into a double. We'll take a look in a later video how to make sure that that actually does happen correctly. For right now, what we're going to do is we're going to assume that it gets checked in the helper function. And so we do the same thing now with our argv square brackets 4, again, for a to f, using a to f and for our radius min. And then lastly, what we want to do is a slightly different function, our a to I of our argv square brackets 5. And again, all that does is it uses, or rather converts it to an integer value as opposed to a double. Now, at this point, you are once again ready to assign our results variable by calling our circle 2DV4. As a matter of fact, you actually at this point don't have to retype this. You could actually just go and copy and paste it from the earlier one. But I'm going to again go through and just simply add all of my variables, including those parallel arrays, starting with the radii, the edge, and the area, the ix, iy, and then our iz. And then the one that you definitely don't want to forget, and it's going to be easy to forget, is going to be the n at the end, which again tells you how many elements are actually supposed to be being used in the array, not necessarily how many were allocated. And at this point, the logic is going to be the same again. It's going to be checking to see if the results are going to be equal to exit success. And at this point, you've probably gotten tired of typing, and you probably have seen the pattern now, and you can probably guess how you would set up the rest of them. But we'll simply go through this. If you are successful in doing the calculations, then you simply provide a little message to the user at this point saying attempted to print fprint the output. Or if for some reason the function fails, then you want to give them some sort of error warning. And probably the only thing I'd like to do is make a quick minor change here. So I have note calling circle and then note attempting to print an fprint. Why don't we, just for consistency's sake, how about if I go ahead and do the same thing here? Again, just trying to let the user differentiate between a note, a warning, and an error. All right, at this point, then we'll go ahead and build it. We're going to come back to our console. And this time around, instead of calling a circle slash I, we're going to call circle slash P. We should get the help if we forget to pass those additional arguments. So it looks like that part is working correctly. Again, we will need to update our help as we go along, but we will go ahead and put in those values from our sample file. And again, you'll see now it seems to be working. It's calling our circle 2DV4, and it's attempting to print F print the output. So we probably only have one other thing just for consistency's sake that we want to do. It didn't put this little helper line in here or this little notice in. So why don't we go ahead and put something like that in here for this branch. I'll just say calling slash circle slash P. And again, you can remove these as you deem necessary once you get done with your application. This is partially for the developer, partially for the user. I think you've probably all used an application that didn't get it, give any feedback back to the user, and you didn't know whether it actually had done anything. Flip side of that, of course, is you can have too much noise back to your user, and then user has no idea what's going on. So there's sort of a compromise or a sweet spot between those two. So hopefully now you see how to get started with this P5. I'll follow up this video with some more videos focusing on the functions and how you'll update the individual arrays and how you do some validation of the input arguments. But fundamentally, for all of the functions, you just simply go through and you now create the vectors or arrays outside in the main, recognizing that you may not use all of them for every one of the functions, but then in the switch or in the appropriate branch of the else if, then you call the function passing not only those single values, but also then the arrays as well that will be updated in the function. Remember that passing the arrays is essentially passing them by address so that they can be updated inside. So hopefully you found this video useful. As always, if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, don't hesitate to reach out to me. And thank you for watching.